Harper Audio presents God and Starbucks, an NBA superstar's journey through addiction and recovery by Vin Baker with Joe Layden. Read by Arnell, Powell. You never know God is all you need until God is all you have. Rick Warren. Introduction. I can see it on their faces sometimes. They walk into the store, heavy-lidded, distracted by thoughts of the upcoming workday, looking for nothing more than a jolt of caffeine to shake off the morning cobwebs. They peck away at their smartphones or fumble with their wallets, oblivious to their surroundings, until suddenly, there they are, at the front of the line, looking up, way up, at the world's tallest barista. Some feign cool indifference, but most can't help themselves. I grew up in Connecticut, played college ball at the University of Hartford, and spent part of my career, a rather notorious part, with the Boston Celtics. So here, at a Starbucks in North Kingstown, Rhode Island, there's no place to hide. First of all, I don't look like an ordinary guy. I'm a giant in the back there. I mean that literally. I'm 6'11", 275 pounds. You see me frothing up your cappuccino, and at the very least, you can't help but wonder, what's going on here? He must be somebody. Others know exactly who I am. A guy who made and lost more than $100 million in his NBA career, a career wrecked by alcoholism and depression and spectacularly bad business decisions. These are the people who stare hard, then suddenly avert their eyes, the sadness nevertheless evident on their faces. I know what they're thinking. How the hell does a four-time NBA All-Star and an Olympian end up shouting, "Tall decaf cappuccino," from behind the counter at Starbucks? Given half the chance, I'll disarm the customer with a smile and a few friendly words. I don't want anyone to feel uncomfortable when they walk into our store, and I sure don't want anyone's pity. Trust me when I say this. I've been through worse, much, much worse. There's no shame in work. The indignity comes from not working, from losing your way through ego and weakness and addiction, and finding yourself tumbling into a bottomless pit of despair and helplessness. Want to know what that looks like? Okay, here it is. I was a first-round NBA draft pick, the eighth choice overall in 1993, smoking weed every day to alleviate my anxiety, until repeated trips to the emergency room with my heart racing uncontrollably prompted me to find another way to self-medicate. I was an NBA All-Star, drinking after games and then before games and eventually at all points in between, draining anywhere between a pint and a fifth of liquor a day, using alcohol to end my career and nearly my life. Make no mistake, that's what alcoholism is. Slow and deliberate suicide. I was a man running from responsibility, fathering five children with two different women, and selfishly bouncing back and forth between families and relationships because money gave me leeway and freedom that others were not afforded. Money, after all, is like a get-out-of-jail-free card. Until it's gone, and with it the patience and tolerance of those you've hurt and the enabling of those who never really cared about you in the first place. I was a former millionaire, driving my mother's Mercedes, the one I bought her with my rookie contract, to a pawn shop with four old tires stuffed in the back seat and trunk. I sold the tires for $80, bought a few bottles of liquor, and drank myself into oblivion. Until all the pain was gone, the ache in my lower back that signaled a failing liver, and the ceaseless cloud of loneliness that hung over every day. That's how bad it got for me. By comparison, working at Starbucks is a walk in the park. Would you prefer to say that I got my ass kicked? That I've been humbled? Fine, go ahead and say it. You would not be incorrect, but I'm not bitter. I've been sober for 6 years now, and in that time, with spirituality as the foundation, I've rebuilt my life one brick at a time. I married a longtime girlfriend, and together we are raising our four beautiful children. I am a licensed minister and assistant pastor at the same church in Old Saybrook, Connecticut, where my father is the head pastor and where, as a boy, I knew nothing but peace. I'll probably never be a millionaire again, but that's fine. Life is good and full of possibilities. That's the point I'd like to get across, that life is worth living, no matter how bad it might get at times. Obstacles can be overcome. Demons can be conquered. I've been speaking to youth groups both in and out of church, and I've done some work with the NBA, helping provide a cautionary tale to young athletes who likely aren't even remotely prepared for the ways in which their lives will change when staggering wealth is heaped on them. This book is part of my mission. Maybe by telling my story, I can provide inspiration and hope to those who are facing all manner of hardships and who are trying to figure out how to pick themselves up and start over again. As I tell the parishioners at my church, God doesn't measure how far you've fallen, but He will be there when you're ready to rise. Prologue. April 16, 2011. This day begins like all the others, like every gray and God-forsaken morning for the previous 7 months, with a feeling of utter astonishment that I am still alive. There is no relief attached to the sentiment, no gratitude, just a sense of wonder at how much the human body can withstand before it finally surrenders or gives out. I roll over on the couch, which is where I usually sleep, and squint out at the bleakness of another day rising up to taunt me. As I sit up, the pounding in my head starts almost immediately, followed by heart palpitations and epic, rumbling waves of nausea. I begin to tremble and sweat. I am dizzy and disoriented. If this sounds like a hangover, well, that doesn't even begin to do it justice. Hangovers are for rookies. I am a veteran, a world-class drinker and drug addict who spends his every waking moment trying to dull the pain of a hopelessly wrecked life. What I feel right now is not a mere hangover. It is a body in the throes of withdrawal. The alcoholic drinks all day, passes out at night, and wakes to a craving that can scarcely be described. An immediate awareness that agony lies ahead, and the only way to stop it is to take the first drink. There's nothing surprising about any of this to me. Not anymore. I know the routine and have planned accordingly. On the coffee table in front of me is a small portion of an orange, peeled and ready to be eaten, along with a jug of Hennessy and an empty glass. Although I don't remember doing so, at some point the previous night, I laid these items out on the table, knowing they would be needed the moment I woke up. And there they are, ready to be applied like some alcoholic's balm. I reach first for the Hennessy, of course. Pour a small amount in the glass, maybe 3 or 4 ounces. Take a deep breath and toss it back. There is a familiar burning sensation, at once soothing and aggravating. Then I put the glass down and reach for the orange. Sometimes I try to eat the entire piece. On this day, I am just too sick. So I squeeze some of the juice into my mouth, try to swallow, and then wait for the inevitable. I reach out, grab a small waste can, also kept nearby at all times, and vomit the meager contents of my stomach, a mix of blood and bile mostly, into the bottom. The spasms go on for a minute or two, dry heaving so powerfully that my ribs feel as though they are compressed against my spine. Whimpering softly, I fall back into the couch and curl up into a ball. In a few minutes, I will begin to feel better. The sweat will dissipate, the headache will subside, and the fog will begin to lift. And then I can begin to drink in earnest. That's the way it usually works. On this day, though, the sickness lingers. There is a persistent pain in my lower back. It's been there for a while now, increasing steadily in severity, a sure sign that my liver is beginning to fail. I rise from the couch, pull a blanket around me, and stagger through darkened rooms. I grew up in this house, and right now it is all I have left. Gone are the mansions and the cars and most of the friends who came with them. My parents live nearby in a home that I bought for them many years ago when I was flush with fame and fortune. We never sold my childhood home, so I moved back in. I guess this is what is known as coming full circle, although I don't recall my parents ever having to worry about the cable company killing service for non-payment, as happened to me not long ago. At the moment, I have 5 children, but I rarely see any of them. Truth is, I hardly see anyone. I've burned just about every available bridge over the last decade, and so most days are spent right here, in this living room, completely alone, drinking as much as a gallon of Hennessy every single day. That's the beverage of choice right now, no better or worse than the Bacardi 151 I used to drink, or even the Listerine I once favored as a way to get drunk without smelling like a drunk. As always, on this morning, I am amazed to be drawing breath. I can't believe I made it through another night. Maybe there is a reason God hasn't called me yet. There was a time, after all, when he was the most important person in my life. Long before I became an NBA All-Star, long before I made and lost more money than most people can even imagine, I lived a life of humility and spirituality. I was the son of a preacher. And even when I lost my way, I like to think of myself as still being part of that flock. It was always back there, somewhere, the idea that I was the prodigal son, just waiting for a chance to go home. I make my way to the bathroom, turn on the lights, and catch a glimpse of myself in the mirror. Most days, I turn away from my own reflection, because what I see disgusts and frightens me. Gone is the world-class athlete with an easy and ever-present smile. In his place is a sad and sick man in the final stages of a death spiral. This is what end-stage alcoholism looks like. Yellow, sunken eyes, hollow cheeks, 190 pounds of sagging, wrinkled flesh draped across a 6'11" frame. In my playing days, I carried 250 pounds of muscle. Now I am a living, breathing skeleton, a walking corpse. For some reason, I stare at the reflection, unable or unwilling to avert my gaze. Every inch of my body aches, not just a superficial pain, but something much deeper and more primal. I feel it in my bones. I feel it in my heart. I feel it in my soul, which is a surprise, since I wasn't even sure that particular part of me still existed. This is bottom. Finally, after all these years, this is it. I begin to cry, almost silently, at first, and then much louder, full-throated sobs that take my breath away. I fall to my knees and, for the first time in many years, I begin to pray. It is a selfish prayer, a plea for relief more than forgiveness. Please, God, take this away from me. I can't do it anymore. There's no response, of course. Just more pain and despair. It's okay. God is a busy man, and you can't blame him for wanting to see some evidence of sincerity before extending the hand of salvation. I rise from the floor and walk into the living room.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.